team together, and then last year together glorious, and this year we talk about together stronger, and even next year we already have the team together impactful, and we talk about a lot of making disciples also next slide. And how you build a relationship with one another, and we do a lot of conversation. That's why we are having this kind of conference setting. They're having fun in the West right now. Actually, one moment we try to have like a satellite, but it probably don't work this year. Maybe next year we'll do it when we can have multiple speakers speaking from different places to create that sense of togetherness. But they're having fun now, about 350 people in Ventura, California. We are having fun here, about 140, 150 of us. And then on the East Coast, I haven't got the pictures yet, but I saw some pictures last night on the West Coast. And we're doing it together. Yeah, together stronger. Everybody said together stronger. So we want to build a relationship and conversation. Paul said to Timothy in 2 Timothy 2, verse 2 to 4, he said that the things which you've heard from me among many witnesses, commit the same to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. And you therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No soldier on duty entangles himself in the affairs of life, that he may please him who enrolled him as soldier. So Paul is saying to Timothy, his son in the Lord, to disciple somebody, a trusted person, who will be able to share to other people. And this is the journey of IFGF. Just last night, my wife posted a picture with Pastor Paul's wife, Vivi. And they've been good friends. They're back there. So I want you to use them as, we haven't practiced this, but this is a real life story. So we don't have to practice. It's just, so I want them to just share a bit on how my wife first met Phoebe, and then she discipled Phoebe back 25 years ago in Stillwater, Oklahoma. So this is ini kesaksian hidup, a real life story. So bisa cerita nggak testimony on gimana dulu cerita? Udah inget-inget belum? What happened actually during that time? Okay, so who wanna start? You
start. I could start. Yeah. That's why I told you guys it's good to be back home. Feels like home. Sekitar more than 20 years ago, aku sekolah di Oklahoma State. And then terus ini ada dulu. Actually, her brother itu kakak kelas saya. Jadi salah one of the Indonesian yang take industrial engineering. So I asked him a lot of questions about the school and everything. And he is also a mentor in Christ also. One day dia juga di doa tim doa syafaat kita. And then dia bilang, guys, please pray for my sister, my younger sister is coming. Vivi. So we have been praying for Fifi. We didn't even know what she looks like or anything, but we have been praying for that name for quite some times, because her brother Rudy told us that a younger sister is coming. She is still Catholic, and she's a bit stubborn also. So when she came, I help her also to ajak-ajakin lah ya. Yuk Vi ikut Bible study and everything. Kemarin dia baru cerita sih, I forgot most of them. Tapi nanti tak masakin. Nanti tak masakin, kamu ikut aja Bible study. And then she came, and then abis dari situ ini ya Vi ya. Apa namanya? Aku sih enggak ingat sih making I don't real apa maksudnya sampai doain kamu, maksudnya doa personal kamu mau terima Tuhan Yesus gitu, kayaknya enggak ya. I think I just ask you to go Bible study. You can continue.
Okay. So When I came to United States in 1988, actually, so I was a bit surprised because actually still water is not, it's very deso gitu ya. But like still water Oklahoma, so I was a little bit shocked. It's actually worse than Malang. I came from Malang. The still water is very, so it's kind of a lonely place gitu ya. And then I was by myself. My brother is busy with his girlfriend and his final project. So I was left, but she shared love to me. So she's my neighbor. She's just across the apartment. And she say, "Oh, V, we're gonna have a girls' Bible study and I'll cook for you." See, I didn't cook, right? When I came here, I didn't cook. I don't know how to cook, but food is always good. So so I'm like very, oh, yes, yes, I want to, you know, like eat with you guys. And during the time Bible study, she's actually sharing the first John 3:16. Was it John 3:16 or the other? Jesus, pokoknya dia cerita. She say, Jesus is the only way. So I have a background from like Catholic, where you know I just think that everyone will be safe as long as you're good, right? No matter what your religion. So when she said that, it struck me, and she just said like one time, "Yes, do you know that the Bible said that Jesus is the only way?" And then I say, "No, I don't know." So it was like a moment of you know, when your veil is you know open, and then you know the truth. It's like enlightenment. So, but then I'm still in the distance. So she thinks that I probably don't really care, but she's actually planting the seed in me. So I was like looking from afar, like I'm watching my brother, and I feel like, oh, he's so, too much to the church, into the church. He's like very serious, very radical. So I say, I don't want to be like that. I'll just step back and watch. But over the 2 years of periods, the seed that she planted is actually give me a chance to grow little by little, until like 2 years later, I was baptized. So I was baptized. I feel like, oh yeah, I want to do what Jesus tell me to do, which is like being baptized. So I baptized, and then you know the story goes on. But it was so beautiful when she doesn't know it. I didn't tell her because I don't know why I don't tell you. But until last night, it was the right time when God say, "Yeah, tell Chris." So I told him, she doesn't even remember what she did. It's only maybe an hour of her time. Maybe not an hour, maybe 1 hour cooking and 1 hour spending time with me. And then even though it seems that I'm not into it, you know, I don't think she knows. She probably feel like, oh, Vivi doesn't believe that, or like, oh, do you feel like that?
Making an impact.
You just spend like 2 hours, 2 hours at that time, it give a seed, and then the seed which is, you know, grow and becomes I am today.
Yeah, wow, awesome. Yeah, beri tepuk tangan. Jangan kemana-mana dulu. Because I just wanna illustrate also the points that like Paul said to Timothy, I've done something to your life. And you trust, find somebody else that you can mentor and trust them with the good news, with the message of the good news. And it's not just Grace doing it alone. Of course, there are some sisters and other brother, including that brother, right?
I'm already.
Just. But Fee, can you just tell, probably just from this audience whose life, I mean, you've been in Austin. Is there any younger? If not, it's your daughter is here.
Yeah.
But find somebody else other than your daughter. that you feel? I mean, we don't practice this. It's just.
I don't know. I'm taking care of the children ministry right now, but I'm kind of like discipling Yvonne and Nina.
Are they here or they're taking care of the children? Is Yvonne in the children?
Yeah.
Okay.
So Yvonne is in youth and Nina is nggak ikut dia. She's in Austin.
She's in Austin. Okay.
But I'm trying to train them to be like the children ministry director, like coordinating children ministry.
Okay. So. Thanks. So this is just to illustrate. Can I have the PowerPoint again where Paul, Timothy, probably at that time Paul for grace is not me but somebody else. Yeah, I think we have to. Okay, you go over there. So it no, here, grace is here. Just pretend that. Okay, so if I'm Paul, this is Timothy, this is the trusted person, and he can trust Nina and Yvonne, right? This is like a chain. And again, the number of four is very. It's not just creative, but this is something that Paul is saying to Timothy. If you do this, this is more than multi-level marketing. Although multi-level marketing stole that ideas, but this is what God is saying. This is what Jesus is saying. We're gonna look into some of the verses, but just in this story, just perhaps this is like Pastor Harminto, one of our pastor, IFGF pastor in Oklahoma, but he's now in Atlanta, pastoring church there. See, he and his wife put a lot of time in us, in our lives, and mentor us. And even a simple 1 or 2 hours just spending time, and then also together with the groups, with the small groups. And then we look at Phoebe now. Even probably just, this is the girl that played the keyboard, Tiffany. Can you just stand over there? Because Tiffany is Paul and Phoebe's daughter. Of course, I want to hear from you. Do you learn anything? What is the thing that you learn from your mom, especially, not just, I mean, your mom, literally mom, but like the spiritual also that you can learn from your mom?
Okay.
Again, this is impromptu.
So. Impromptu, yeah. My mom is very disciplined. If she wants to do something, she'll do it. I like stop halfway through my projects. I have probably 10 unfinished craft projects in my closet, but my mom is someone that like finishes things out, and she's always like, "Go finish your thing, or do that, or do this." But she's very disciplined in carrying things out through the
end. And what do you learn the most from your mom spiritually?
Oh,
in knowing or following Jesus.
I think from a young, like me as a young child, she has always like shared Bible stories with me.
Okay.
And she worships. Even when I was in her tummy, she'd play piano and sing worship.
Okay. How do you know that? Can you hear that?
She told me.
Yeah, that's a picture.
Yeah, if you actually listen to my piano, the style is very similar to hers.
Oh.
So worship, she introduced me to a life of music and arts. And that's one way that I glorify the Lord. And he has displayed his glory in that way. And she's like introduced. Daddy doesn't really do the arts, yeah. mommy really cared to cultivate arts, and she saw potential in mm-hmm. that area that I could be a musical person. So.
All right. Okay. Thanks a lot, Tiffany. So, give it up for Grace, Fifi, and Tiffany. Thank you very much. So, going back to this, these are the stories of. The gospel, actually, when Jesus called all his disciples, 12 of them, and even Jesus, one of the disciples, failed. But out of that, 11, and then the good news, the gospels being spread out. Next slide, please. So I'm going to share a bit now about discipleship. The word discipleship, pemuritan, probably lately now, if the Christian hear the word of discipleship, they're kind of like, oh, yeah, what is that? What is that? But actually, discipleship is to build a relationship with God and with others. It's not just a relationship with others and how you train a disciple. And a lot of people think in discipleship is making somebody do the things that you want. But actually, it will start with connecting yourself with God. Discipleship is a call to follow Jesus. Matthew 4:19 said, he said to them, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. So talking about discipleship, the first thing is not about you disciple others, but you being discipled by Jesus himself. If you believe that, say hallelujah. If you believe that, say amen. So discipleship is about ourselves following our Savior, Jesus. That's why last night I shared about how every day we need to be in charge in the presence of God. Last night I talked about if you have a cell phone, you don't forget to charge it every day. Have you charged your cell phone this morning? Right? We remember to charge our cell phone, because if not, it's not going to be a breakthrough. It's going to be a breakdown. We cannot use it. We cannot use our phone. We cannot use the GPS. We can get lost. But a lot of us prioritize on that, this physical thing, and forgot about the spiritual thing. When discipleship is calling about following Jesus, to follow our Jesus, to have a quiet time with him every day, to have a prayer time with him, to have a worship time, to worship him, so we don't magnify our problems, but we magnify God, to remember what he did for our lives, the covenant relationship with him, to spend time with the word of God, to eat your spiritual bread every day. So the call of discipleship is about the call to follow Jesus. And then not just following Jesus alone, we fellowship with believers. Discipleship is a call to fellowship with other believers. Hebrews 10:24-25, and let us consider one another to provoke to love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as in the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much more as you see the day approaching. Forgive about the probably there is some change in the format. So it's a call to fellowship. If you are in IFGF for just a few years, maybe some of you, we don't tell about what it stands for. But at the beginning, in the 80s, it's Indonesian Full Gospel Fellowship. It's just started with fellowship. And we still have the eyewitness here, probably, Ibu Muti. Well, what year you joined IFGF? Back in 1984, yeah? And I joined IFGF with Grace 1987. So during that time, we only have 4 churches in Los Angeles, in Fresno, San Francisco, and Stillwater. But we are very strong in fellowship. That's why we call ourselves Indonesian Full Gospel Fellowship. But in year 2000, we see the call is not just disciple Indonesians, but disciple all nations. That's why we go into nations and we change it. The IFGF become International Full Gospel Fellowship. And now we have churches, a lot of churches in Africa. Last week I just got back from Pakistan. We have 60 churches in Pakistan. Pastor Herman now is in Africa with hundreds of pastors there also. So we're growing. We're growing very fast in Nepal with indigenous leaders in that nations. So it's a call to fellowship with other believers. Although we are growing, I mean spread horizontally, we still make sure that every one of us, we're a church that we want to know one another, right? We're not the church that, oh, okay, let's have a big gathering and then have fun and then go home. And we don't really care with what happened in other people's life. We want to be a church like like that 5 people, the 4 and the 1 paralyzed. They care for one another. They're thinking and praying for one another. They're helping, they're supporting one another because we have fellowship. It's a call. Discipleship is a call to fellowship with other believers. And the last one, discipleship is the call to fish for men. Matthew 9:9-13, and as Jesus passed on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax office. During that time, people don't like the tax collector. I think even right now, people don't like tax collector. Hopefully nobody here work from in tax collectors. But Grace Auntie work in IRS. But even during that time, people don't like a tax collector. But Jesus said to him, "Follow me," and he arose and followed him. Again, remember, discipleship is about following Jesus. And it happened as Jesus reclined the house, behold, many tax collectors, sinners came and were reclining with him and his disciples. And when the Pharisees saw, they said to his disciples, "Why does your master eat with tax collectors and sinners?" I think sometimes until this day, a lot of Christians, they still have more a judgmental spirit. It's like a modern kind of Pharisees. And when they see, somebody walking in the church, probably with earrings and tattoos, I think everybody's going to look, who is this? With that judgmental eyes, not with the compassion of Jesus. Again, that's what happened when Jesus was sitting with sinners. And Jesus heard that. He said to them, "The ones who are whole do not need a physician, but the ones who are sick. But go and what is that? I will have mercy and not sacrifice, for I have not come to call the righteous, but the sinners to repentance." So discipleship is called to fish for men. A lot of Christians try to start the fishing time is when people come to church. Just for example, this is like the zero point. This is the point of repentance. This is the point of born again. Just say this is the point zero. And then after that, people will grow in following Jesus, right? They go to plus one, plus two, plus three, plus five, etc. And then they serve the Lord, etc., etc. Some of them become pastors. Some of them become pastorpreneur. But they grow in their maturity in the Lord. But if we talk about discipleship, it will not start at point zero. It's got to be starting probably it's at minus 10. Some of our friends, our family, probably they're quite far away. Probably they're at minus 300. They seem so far away. And we thought, I don't think that guy or that girl can ever get saved. But Jesus said, I don't come for those who are whole, but those who are sick. Those who are in minus 200, those who are in minus 300. How many of you here have friends or family members that probably you think, he's or she's so far away from the Lord? Do you have that kind of friend or family, right? I still have friends from my high school, from my college. They're just so far from the Lord. I think if we don't have that kind of friend, we should pray. Not that I said, you should go and make a lot of friends with sinners. I'm not saying that. But if you are just, like a pastor, sometimes it's hard for a full-time pastor because every day he will deal with a lot of Christians. I'm thankful that I still have a chance to be in the marketplace also where I meet all kind of people. My hobby is golf. And I'll try to play golf one time with Christians, member of the church, where we always say nice things even when we hit it bad. But time to time I will play with another golfer. They're not Christian. Some of them still smoke. Some of them still swear, etc. Although later on when they find out that I'm a pastor, sometimes they make a joke. Be careful what you say. We have a pastor around us. But you should still engage with people that are in the minus zone. They have not known the Lord. Speak to you, some of the young people, you still have a lot of friends at your school, at your university. They're probably still on drugs. They probably don't have, they don't know what their future look like. But if you are a friend, just like what Grace is, is not, Fifi is not the minus 500. Fifi is a nice girl, but she's still in minus 10 at that time probably, and if nobody approaches her, and probably looking at the brother also is a good friend of mine, Rudy is a good, and she's so busy and get a girlfriend at that time, etc. Probably Fifi will look, if Christian like that, probably she's gonna be in minus 15. And probably if she met a Christian that doesn't care about her, she go minus 20. But praise the Lord, she got a girl that wanna cook for her. So she go to minus 5. Amen. You see what I'm saying? And then at the right time, she received Jesus as her Savior. And from then on, she grows. From then on, she involves in small groups. She begin to serve, begin to play keyboard, worship led, met a great young man at the church. And now they're serving together in IFGF Austin. Amen. Can you see that? Can you see that journey of discipleship? It's not just about telling somebody this you should do, this you should not do. But it starts with following Jesus. It starts with your life. If you build your life, you have something to offer. You have food to offer. You have your lifestyle to offer. You have your, I mean, you don't even have to say anything. Just like Francis Assisi, I think he's the one that said this. Preach the gospel at all times. And when necessary, use words. So you don't have to use words. You can use your cooking talent. Just like Pastor Drew was saying, doing the Gatorade, doing anything. You don't have to preach and using the megaphone and repent or you go to hell. There are days of that. But, well, anyway, we did that also in the first of summer mission when Pastor Jimmy, Pastor Denny still do that in a train station in Amsterdam. But we didn't do that. I mean, we still preach the gospel. But every day, setiap hari, I think we need to be intentional about what we do with our life. If we want to be a disciple makers, start with following Jesus, continue with fellowshipping with believers, and then to fish for people. And again, the fishing for people part, I love when Jesus said, because his illustration is not using pole fishing, but using nets, right? When using nets, you cannot do it alone. You need friend. You need somebody. That's why like Grace, probably she just did 1 hour, 2 hours, but there are other sisters. There are people that are praying. When Rudy said about the name Fifi, I think probably 10 or 15 people are praying. 10 or 15 people are catching the fish together. So use this opportunity to make disciples, starting with following Jesus. So remember, it is easy, right? 3F, follow Jesus, fellowship with believers, and fish for men. So that's the basic. I'm just going to share a story. Every year, usually I challenge myself personally. So I have to intentionally, because I'm running around from place to place. But even this year, I have somebody that I've known for the last 3 years. He's one of the top, probably the financial executives. And there are times that after 3 years making friends, one day he said this, can I have time with you just to know about God? That's after 3 years of friendship. Not talking about so much about the word of God, just knowing, and he's seeing my life, and he knows that I'm a pastor, preneur also. So his background is Catholic, so he's probably in the minus 20 zone. It's not the minus 500. But then he didn't know about the salvation. He didn't know about spending time with the Lord. So this year, I met him, just have lunch already 5 times, bring him to this point until he received Jesus as his Savior. He still have a long way to go to grow in his relationship with Jesus. But my point is, and this is my challenge to all of us this morning, do you have that kind of friends? When we talk about together stronger, and this morning the story, do you have that paralyzed man that needs you to help him or to help her? She's probably just live nearby, your neighbor. She's probably your friends at school, friends in the workplace. So this morning I want you, later on we're gonna pray together for that person. Because together stronger, it's about helping out to other people. Together stronger is about not just about yourself, but about other people also. So I want to continue with why we need to disciple. There are a few things, just real quick. When Jesus said, therefore, go teach to all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father and Son and Holy Spirit. Because we know that everybody is precious. Everybody needs somebody else, right? How many of us here can live just by yourself? Nobody. I'm so thankful that during this trip, my wife can be with me. Although two of my children do not agree. And they said, why you take mommy this time? I said, well, you already have mom. I was in Pakistan alone in a week, so I better have your mom with me. And we were praying, we were laughing. And we called them, and they already said the first word, we miss you. Well, anyway, I can get emotional thinking about them. Let me continue. But everyone need anybody else. Everyone need accountability with one another. And I'm glad when growing in the Lord, I have somebody that kind of like check on me, check on my life, on how I live. Even right now, time to time with Pastor Jimmy, he still come to me and ask, how is family, how is finances, how is your relationship with your wife, everything okay? And most of the time, I'm praise the Lord, I'm not the type that kind of like, bikin repot gitu ya. I said most of the time it's okay, but there are times I will ask advice also from Pastor Jimmy. So everyone needs accountability. Everyone need teaching, because there are times that we don't know everything, right? That's why we need teachers, and everyone need a prayer. It's good to have somebody around you that you can pray and share your burden. There are times that when Grace and I have issues, not fighting. I mean, we're glad we've been married 21 years, and we never really fight. We have our disagreement, but we never fight. Never fight like UFC fight or or throwing piring terbang. We never have that. Never slammed the door, never yelled at her, but we have our differences. But when we have our differences, then we bring it up to God, we pray, and that's why together stronger. And there are times that I ask some of my friends, especially the leadership or pastor, to pray also for certain issues in our family. So it's good to have one another in your growing in the Lord. Okay, and now I want to go over. Last night I gave you five tips on how we connect with God. Some of the words that actually been in IFGF movement. So if you remember, there are word about mission, right? In our vision statement, we've discussed about this. Basically, go therefore and make disciples of all nations. I think I will encourage you also to go in a mission trip. It's good. Pastor Danny every year will take the team to go to Indonesia time to time. Next year I will ask some of my members in the church to go. How many of you want to go to Pakistan with me, right? To start praying and to see what God is doing in other nations, because that's one of the things which is good, and see how the Spirit is moving. It's in Pakistan just last week. You can see that they're very simple people over there. And a lot of us probably can enjoy life a lot better here in the States and even in Indonesia. But in Pakistan, they're very simple people. And we have 60 churches in Pakistan. But just looking at the pastor's life, the leaders there, One of it is Pastor Salim. And he's a very simple man. He's a school teacher. And he's been faithfully teaching for, I think, 25 years. And teaching music at the school. And basically the student, 99.9% are Muslim in the schools. But he can be a blessing. When he finishes teaching at 4 o'clock, he will go home at 5. He will take rest for about an hour. And then from 6 o'clock to midnight, he will go from house to house just to have fellowship with other believers, to share, to pray for people. And he's faithfully doing that. He lives in Lahore. I was there, I think, 10 years ago. But until now, he still serves faithfully. He's about into retirement right now. I think he will quit in December and then finally decided to go full-time. And he's the one that's going to lead our movement in Pakistan with Pastor Justin in Islamabad. And it's not easy. Some of you heard probably Pastor Robinson, our leader there, that was kidnapped and that he got to leave the country. He's trying to be here and also in UK, so we're praying for him also. So it's not easy over there, but we're glad that when we talk about making disciples, it can be, I mean, in Pakistan. I share the same thing. And to see that illustration, when you see myself, Grace, Vivi, and then Tiffany, in Pakistan, the same thing happened. In the pastoral team, I can see Dr. Robinson, although he's not there, but he got his disciple, Pastor Justin. And Pastor Justin has disciple, Pastor Imran. He's my interpreter. And Pastor Imran has another young man named Javid. It's talking about discipleship. It's talking about lifestyle. Ya, gaya hidup yang luar biasa yang kita bisa lihat di dalam kehidupan kita. So it's mission. And you can start not just in Pakistan, you can start with someone close to you. So I want you to think about somebody. Just one person that you want to pray during this retreat. Maybe he's in just minus one. Probably just take 30 minutes. You spend time with him. And maybe the Holy Spirit will remind you of a person that's in minus 10. Or maybe still far away, minus 100, whatever. But think about that person and pray about that person during this retreat. Start with that simple thing. Every one of you. Maybe he's in your neighborhood, school, tempat kerja. Maybe your family relatives back home. I have a testimony that I prayed for my grandpa and grandma to know the Lord. That took me 13 years and 11 years before finally they got to know Jesus. But it started somewhere. And I pray that during this retreat you will have that name. Put it in your Bible. Put it in your notes. Just pray. Keep on praying for that name. And if opportunity comes, make intentional. Yeah, make time. Remember the story again, that 4 person, if you make that time, it will become a breakthrough for you and for that person. See, if you have that opportunity, sometimes you don't just wait, but you create that opportunity. Like Grace, she created it by cooking. When about the person that I'm sharing, he's already opening up, but I have to schedule myself. He's a very busy man. And it's very hard just to have a lunch appointment. Sometimes he's in town, and then I'm not in town. Like he was asking me, I can do it this week. Oh, I said, I will be in the States. And then when I got back to Jakarta, I'm in Jakarta. Where are you? I'm in UK. So he's just got like a year. We try to meet like actually the first, okay, let's do it once a month. What happened? For 10 months, we just met 5 times. So it's like every other month. It's not easy. So I'm trying to meet him again 2 weeks from now. I put it in my calendar. Okay, you put it also in your calendar. But the point is you need to be intentional in doing your mission. There's a small scale of mission, personal mission. There's also country that you can go. So you can have it. In IFGF, we do it. The small scale and also the big scale, okay? All right, and then when you do it, it's not just by trying to be a pushy person, but you're doing it out of your lifestyle. I call it a balanced lifestyle. A balanced lifestyle, which we are no longer children, tossed away to and fro and carried about in every wind of doctrine by the trickery of man and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. But we grow. I love last night during the talk show when Vivi said, one thing about my husband, Paul, I think he's a very balanced, mature, right? Full of wisdom. That's what she said. But that's the way people should look into us, right? People should look into us and say, wow, I think there is something that I can learn from this person. There's something that although he's busy, although he's under pressure, you know, you don't have to testify all the time with the great things that happen in your life. You're not Superman, right? Superman have all the power and everything. But orang kadang-kadang tuh bisa relate justru dengan hal-hal mungkin kelemahan kita, our weaknesses. Oleh sebab itu saya selalu bilang, even I'm a pastor, I'm not perfect. Saya ini gak sempurna. Sebagai orang tua, sebagai parents, sebagai husband, I'm not perfect. Although close to it probably. But I'm not perfect. There are days that I'm just tired. There are days that I just get easily irritated. But people will relate if you're being an authentic person. I mean, a balance. It's not just, oh, look at me. I'm the super pastor. You know, I'm wearing SP. Not Somi Pranoto, SP. Super pastor. But but you can see, I journal every day the thing that happened in my life. And I said, my wife, you can see my life. It's an open letter. What are the verses I'm reading? Even now, I put how many hours I sleep and I pray. Just to be open. And people can see what are the verses God is speaking to me, not just because I'm preparing for a sermon or a teaching. But and then when I do my gym, I put it in, which is now I'm very bad. I didn't go to the gym for the last, I think, 2-3 months. It's so bad. I'm starting gaining 2-3 kilograms more weight, and then it's. But that's life. I'm not saying I'm a perfect, and I'm a very high, you know, in personality. I'm a very high C. So usually I just count my time and everything that I do. I do a statistic, you know, percentage of everything. But again, I said, well, I'm not perfect, but I'm glad, you know. There is a word for it, ya. Justru di dalam kelemahan, disitulah apa saudara, kasih karunia Tuhan itu makin melimpah. Jadi saya bisa melihat, bukan not trying to make excuses, tapi saya bersyukur bahwa justru ini bisa membawa saya juga orang jadi pengharapan. Iya ya, memang nggak harus sempurna. Tapi ketika again kita ini follow Jesus, we fellowship with others, kita bisa saling menguatkan. Kita juga bisa bawa orang lain. Yang di minus ini gak ngelihat orang Kristen kayaknya, wah, gue gak bisa deh jadi kayak gitu. Itu orang-orang yang kumpulannya judging people. Gereja udah lama dikenal sebagai tempat di mana, oh ini gak boleh, itu gak boleh, ini gak boleh, itu gak boleh, ini gak boleh, itu gak boleh. Selalu mulainya dari judgmental position. Tapi Yesus gak pernah begitu, right? Dia lihat Matthew the tax collector, dia gak lihat dari situ, dia lihat Zacchaeus. Kalau dia lihatnya dari judging point of view, udah gak bakal datang dia ke dalam kingdom of God. Tetapi dia lihat dari acceptance. Tuhan terima dulu. Tuhan bilang, lu Matius, kadang-kadang gereja tuh gitu, lu berubah dulu ya. Stop ngerokok dulu. Hapus tatonya dulu gitu ya. Stop semua. Nanti lu baru terima Yesus, baru ngikutin. Yesus gimana caranya? How is Jesus, what did Jesus do? Matthew, come, follow me. Dia bilang, ikut dulu. Saya punya kesaksian juga seorang teman. Dulu belum pendek rambutnya, gitu. Sekarang udah pendek rapi. Dulu rambutnya panjang, gitu ya. Kalau saya sebut namanya, Vivi mungkin tahu juga, tapi saya nggak sebut namanya lah. Itu rambutnya panjang, itu lagi datang, kayaknya hidupnya madesu, masa depan suram. Itu susah nerjemahinnya. But anyway, dia rasanya, tapi waktu saya ketemu, kemudian saya ngomong, dia terima Tuhan, dan kemudian apa yang terjadi, dia bisa begitu memberikan kehidupannya, dan menjadi seorang hamba Tuhan yang luar biasa. Kemanapun dia berada. Saya punya satu teman lagi, kalau ini saya boleh bilang namanya. Pak Yonatan mungkin kenal, karena dia di GBI, Pak. Namanya Franciscus Irwan Wijaya. Ini Iwan, waktu itu dia ketua Permias, saya sekjennya Permias. Dia di Batam, Pak, kalau pernah di bagian misi sama Pak Johan dia. Tapi dia ini waktu ketua Permias, dia ini punya banyak jimat. Wow, banyak banget. Jimatnya tuh banyak. Dan saya waktu itu berdua ngobrol sama dia. Saya bilang sama dia, kamu emangnya jimat itu bisa buat apa gitu ya. Wow, ini bisa buat kebal. Yang ini bisa gini. Yang ini buat cewek, ada juga gitu ya. Buat macam-macam ya saudara. Dan ini yang terjadi sama dia. Saya I've been praying for him. Karena saya tahu ini anak punya potensi yang sangat besar. Tapi mungkin poinnya dia di minus. Katanya sih Katolik, tapi juga gak ke gereja. Mungkin dia minus 500. Banyak roh jahatnya. Seriously. Itu dia yang namanya saya ngebawa dia gitu ya. Sampai minus 300, 200, 100. Sampai akhirnya one point. Ini this is a real story. Tapi saya ceritain aja ini. Karena kita lagi ngomongin making disciples. Itu saya lagi jalan ke sekolah, ini karena di Dallas jadi ada cerita-cerita Oklahoma bisa muncul lagi. itu winter, saya masih ingat, itu kira-kira mungkin Februari, jadi snowing. Saya jalan ke sekolah, tiba-tiba dari dalam hati saya tuh kayak Roh Kudus cuma ingetin, dan coba kamu mampir ke rumahnya Iwan. Jadi saya lagi jalan itu saya bilang, ah ini bener gak sih suara Roh Kudus, dingin gitu ya. Saya lagi jalan mau ke library. Bukan mau ketemuin Vivi sama Paulus yang suka pacaran di library. Tapi memang saya lagi mau ke library. Lalu tiba-tiba Roh Kudus udah makin dekat. Saya masih bilang, ah ngapain sih ini salah kali, ini mau-maunya saya. Sampai saya udah benar-benar dekat library, karena ke tempatnya dia tuh mesti going to the other direction. Tapi sebelum saya masuk library, itu kalau yang dari Stillwater beberapa tahu, udah lewatin engineering north building, gitu, engineering south, tinggal muter dikit lagi sampai, gak tahan lagi, saya bilang, ah udah dah, whatever it is. Dulu masih belum ada cell phone segala macam, kalau sekarang kan bisa kontak dulu, apa kabar. Gak ada cell phone, ya udah saya jalan aja ke tempatnya dia. Itu sebab 10 minutes walk, I think 10-15 minutes walk, dingin, cold. Sampai di depan pintu rumahnya saya ketok. Gak ada jawaban pertama, kedua udah dingin gitu ya. Saya bilang, waduh jangan-jangan gak ada orang nih, percuma. Jangan-jangan gue kurang sensitif dengar suara Roh Kudus, salah denger gitu. Tapi tiba-tiba pas saya ketok ketiga, pintunya dibuka. Ini Iwan ini lagi pegang senjata, saudara, senapan. Karena dia punya senapan. Dia mukanya lagi merah dan dia bilang, gila Den, gitu, ini bikin gue kesel, gue mau bunuh dia. Kamu belum pernah dengar cerita ini ya? Oke, jadi saya ceritain. Dan benar-benar dia pegang senjata itu, ini gue udah isi peluru. Karena dia memang suka nembak juga, berburu. Udah ada bulan, saya bilang, tenang-tenang dulu. Nggak bisa, gue udah mau jalan sekarang. Tenang-tenang dulu. Terus saya saking takut, keluarin dulu pelurunya gitu. Biar gimana saya ngeri juga. I'm really scared. So benar-benar dia lagi marah sama satu anak Indonesia lain. Jadi dia sebut namanya. Dia mau nipu. Terus akhirnya dia bisa tenang, dikeluarin pelurunya gitu ya. Wah. Terus saya doain dia, terus dia bisa lemes gitu ya. Tapi itu belum selesai. Karena habis itu ya itu bisa ada manifestasi, pelepasan. Dan ada momen pada saat itu kita ngelepasin segala roh naga, roh ular, macam-macam lah gitu ya. This is just real, the evil spirit that is in him. Tapi apa yang terjadi sekarang, saudara, dia sekarang hamba Tuhan yang dipakai luar biasa ya untuk mission. Ya. Tapi that's just a small thing. Kenapa sih saya cerita? I'm not just about bragging atau gimana. Tapi setiap kita, Tuhan tuh bisa pakai. Ya gak usah cari yang jauh-jauh dulu, nanti akan ada waktunya. Tapi saya mau nanya lagi, berapa dari Anda udah nulis tuh 1%? Just 1% yang tadi saya udah bilang, can I see your hands? Kalau enggak saya akan khotbah terus sampai semua punya satu nama. Siapa yang udah punya nama gitu ya. Just you don't have to preach directly to him. Just be friend. Just pray for him. Just pray for her. Take him to lunch. Make sure kamu yang bayarin. Gitu ya. Right? Atau kamu yang masakin. Do something good to people. Ya. Yeah. Nah. So pagi hari ini, ayo sama-sama. Dan saya bersyukur Iwan itu sekarang dipakai luar biasa. Ya karena saya mau ke poin berikutnya tentang giving. Ya, ini nggak cuma talking about giving money, but giving your time. Kenapa tadi saya cerita itu? Karena saya lagi mau tes sebenarnya, mau ke library, mau belajar. Walaupun saya orang-orang suka iri sama saya, kamu kok belajar sebentar bisa dapat bagus gitu ya. Tapi saya tetap harus belajar gitu. Dan itu mau tes gitu. Dan apa yang terjadi, I need to give time. Dan memberikan waktu. Dan itu cukup lama karena udah saya doain, nangis, pelepasan semua. It's all kind of things yang terjadi. Tapi saya teringat ini dari The Message ya. I tell you, love your enemies, help and give without expecting a return. You'll never, I promise, regret it. Dan saya, waktu itu Iwan bukan musuh saya gitu ya. Tapi, I'll never regret it. Sampai hari ini kalau keinget cerita itu saya, waduh, I feel so amazed. Karena dia sekarang udah memberikan dampak, pengaruh yang luar biasa. Live out this God created identity the way our Father lives toward us. He's generous, He's gracious. Even when we are at our worst, our Father is kind. You be kind, right? Kalau Tuhan tuh ngelihat kita cuma di point, oh udah rapi semua, udah terima Yesus, udah baik, kayaknya gampang. But how about seeing people in the point of minus 100, minus 200, minus 300, and still far away? Soalnya gak pernah tahu apa yang Roh Kudus bisa lakukan. Kenapa? Karena Tuhan mengasihi semua orang. Tuhan datang untuk yang sakit, bukan untuk yang sehat. Yang percaya katakan amin. So give your time. Berikan waktumu untuk satu dengan yang lain. Dengan demikian, engkau bisa membawa mereka semakin dekat dengan Tuhan. Berikutnya, about excellent. If you do things excellently, Colossians 3:23 says, and don't just do the minimum that will get you by. Do your best, work from the heart for your real master, for God. Dan ini saya ingat ini dari papi saya. Waktu itu saya masih SMP, SD lah, SD. Dan saya selalu dapat angkanya bagus, saya selalu make it to the top 10 out of 15 students in the class. No, out of about 40 students, I definitely, I will always be in the top 10. Grade saya gak pernah 6, 7 gitu, pasti 8, 7, 8, 9. Tapi saya gak pernah jadi juara kelas. Paling bagus jadi juara 3. Lalu papi saya ngomong begini, Den, kamu, kan kemarin saya udah cerita saya di Ancol. Papi saya bilang begini, kalau kamu belajar sedikit aja lebih rajin, kamu bakal bisa jadi excellent. Mungkin kamu bisa juara 1. Terus saya bilang sama papa saya, Pak, ngapain jadi juara 1? Mendingan gini, relax, hidup, bisa nyantai, main. Yang penting kan saya selalu naik kelas, gak pernah nyusahin papi gitu ya. Saya selalu bilang gitu. Lalu papi saya bilang, enggak bisa begitu. Kalau Tuhan udah kasih talenta, dia pakai ayat juga. Pakai ayat deh, keluarin ayat. Saya masih ingat talenta. Kan Tuhan lihat, kalau kamu dapat talentanya banyak, ya kamu harus kembangkan. Terus saya pakai alasan lagi. Kenyataan aja, Pi. Itu lihat teman papi. Karena satu ada teman papi saya itu pinter banget. Dia itu arsitek, lulusan ITB. Dan dia yang desain itu banyak dulu tuh. Gelanggang renang, pondok putri, duyung. He's very genius lah. Tapi saking mungkin, dulu saya pikir karena saking pinternya dia jadi begini. Gitu. Lalu saya bilang, ntar jadi begini kalau kepinteran. Gitu. Atau jadi nerd. Lalu papi saya bilang, enggak, dia gitu karena dia enggak kenal Tuhan. Kalau kamu kenal Tuhan, do the best that you can do. Kamu itu memuliakan Tuhan. Kamu itu bisa jadi yang Alkitab juga bilang, papi saya puji Tuhan, dia suka baca Alkitab juga gitu ya. Dia bilang, kamu itu jadi terang, nanti orang melihat kamu melakukan sesuatu, orang bisa terinspirasi kehidupannya. Dan mulai hari itu, saya bilang, okay ya, Pi, belajarnya tambah dikit aja kan, mainnya masih boleh, itu karena saya masih SD. Tapi akhirnya waktu SMP, itu lebih bagus gitu ya. Jadi waktu udah SMP, ya gak selalu ranking 1 juga, kadang ranking 1, kadang 2, kadang 3, tapi mostly udah di top 3 or 4. Ya, kenapa? Karena ya saya cuma belajar lebih dikit. Waktu SMA juga sama gitu. Juga gak nomor 1 gitu, tapi in the top 3. Ya, dan saya bersyukur untuk kesempatan. Jadi orang-orang bisa terinspirasi kehidupannya. Kalau ada di sini Pastor Peter lagi ngajar anak-anak juga sih kali ya. Tapi kalau enggak yang dulu sekolah industrial engineering, file saya itu ternyata menjadi legacy, peninggalan yang baik. Karena angkanya bagus, itu buat referensi buat siswa industrial engineering yang lain di Oklahoma State University. Ya, karena hasil-hasil yang baik. So, whatever you do it heartily as to the Lord and not to the man, right? Do your best, work from the heart for your real master, for God. So whatever you do, in school, I'm glad sometimes when I share this story, parents will come to me and say, thank you for sharing that. I don't have to yell at my son anymore right now, but he's inspired to study a little bit more. I hope I inspire some of the students here. If you're making B's, I mean, you can have A's, right? And I inspire a girl so much, and she listened to me, and finally made her become my wife. Because she used to make B's, and then when she took her MBA, she made 4.0s, right? But during undergrad, she's just making B, 3 point something. Yeah. But MBA, she's a 4.0, and I'm making 1 B. I got 3.9. But the point I'm sharing this, you don't have to start far. If you're working right now, be the best in your field. Be the best in your field. If you're an accountant, I love sharing with Pastor Marcus. He's the complex accounting situation guy. If there is a complex accounting situation, people will go to him, right? So you need to be excellent in whatever you do. If you're in school, make 4.0s and still be relevant. Don't be a nerd, right? Be relevant. When people talk football, you know about football, right? When people talk about lives, you still can talk about those things. When people talk about Taylor Swift, you know Taylor Swift. People talk about Justin Bieber. Okay, I know Justin Bieber. It's not becoming weird people, but you're still being relevant and be the best God prepare you to be. If you believe that, say amen. Amen? All right. So excellent in doing things. And then the last one, I'm going to land with this verse again. At the end of the day, it's about reproducing yourself. Reproducing leaders. The things you've heard from me among many witnesses, commit again to this faithful man. So you will start actually with that one person. You will remember probably 10 years from now that on Thanksgiving Day in Camp Copass, Denton, Texas, that you're praying for this one person. And you never know what God will take him, what great plans that God has given this person, that he want to use you to be his arm, to be the one that give him a call, to be the one that take him to lunch, to be friend to them, to be the one that share the good news, to be the one that bring him or her from minus 300 to minus 200 to minus 100 to the point when they receive Jesus as their personal Savior, baptized in water, baptized in the Holy Spirit, growing in knowledge of God, being in a small group setting, fellowship with other believers, following Jesus, and one day he can also feast for others, because that person will have maybe a family. I was just talking to one pastor that just shared this testimony that encouraged me. You know what? He just said, actually, I was just preaching to this one person. But, and then this one person invited me to come to his whole house. So his father, his mother, his brothers and sisters, about 8 of them. So we have that small groups directly in his house. Why? Because he's faithful to give time. Remember, he got a mission. And he can use his life, his blessed life, balanced life. And he's giving his time. He's probably giving his money. Treat him lunch, treat her lunch. But he do things excellently. So you can be a testimony. And you can bring others to God. Amen. So I want to conclude with one final slide. When we talk about people, it's our mission. Pastor Jimmy, the founder, basically have these 10 things. About prayer, power, worship, covenant, word, mission, balance, giving, excellence, and leadership. And these are the things that we want to clarify also to our movement. Because last August when the apostolic team meeting, and when people, we basically in IFGF, we all know people is our mission. It's about people. We do things for people. So, but we want to clarify. So people that can connect with God. Last night I was sharing, it's simple. It's your life. Are you still connecting with God every day in your life? Because you need that to make disciples. All right? So final slide. So that's our logo with the people is our mission as a mission statement. And the clarifying connect with God. Make disciples. Amen. Are you getting something? Amen. All right. Okay.